Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode is sponsored in part by Highland Woodworking. Visit their website at highlandwoodworking.com. And also by Lee Valley and Veritas. Visit their website at leevalley.com. Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop Podcast. So for today's episode, we're starting a brand new project, and this is going to be a set of bookshelves that's going along with the child's dresser that we just finished. Now again, because I kind of fell behind on the child's dresser, I'm in a time-sensitive kind of a situation, and I really need to start moving forward on this. So to help speed things along, what I've done is I've already taken the rough lumber, I've milled it, and I've got it to the basic dimensions that I need. Of course, we're going to need to tweak things here and there, but all in all, we're pretty much at the point of assembly with some light joinery going on. Now, in this episode, or in this project, we're going to be doing just some very basic joinery, butt joints, and then I'm going to be reinforcing them, actually, with pocket holes. Now, we don't really use pocket holes that often here, but one thing I do when I do use them is I try to conceal them the best I can. I want them in locations that you're not going to see unless you really go looking for them. So we'll talk a little bit more about that as the joinery comes up. Now, the first thing we need to do, of course, is to figure out what we're going to start gluing up first to get the whole assembly going. And I pretty much have the shelves all set. They're all glued. Like I said, I've already dimensioned those. Now what I want to start with is the side panels themselves. And the side panels are going to be made up of these laminated legs. Now, initially the plans called for 1.5 by 1.5, but as I often do, and I'm sure many of you do it the same thing, once in a while you kind of alter plans as you go. The main thing, of course, is to make sure that if you do make any alterations that you account for it throughout the whole entire plan before you take the next step. And so rather than 1.5 by 1.5, we have 1.75 by about 1.5. And so, or is that, yeah, let's take a look. Let's just double check it so that I'm not coming up later on and saying, oh, it's this instead. Yeah, 1.75 by, oh, this is coming in at more like 1.25. And so it's definitely a drastic difference between the 1.5 and 1.5 that we originally had planned on using, but I think it's going to work really great in the final project. Now, the first thing I want to do is I'm going to take two of the laminated legs, and I have a panel that's going to go in between them, so we're going to glue that up. But before we even get to that, one of the things I want to do is, for the shelves, rather than drilling holes in the panels and just using pins to hold them in place, I've decided I'm going to use these uprights right here, these adjustable shelf supports. And so I went out to my local home center and I picked up a couple of these. In fact, we're going to be making two sets of bookshelves, bookcases, and I'm going to need approximately, I'm going to need 8 of these total. So I went ahead and picked up 4, and I'll be able to cut them in half and put them in place, and we'll definitely, I'll show you as we go into this. But what I really like about this is, it feels like it's a little bit more secure, and I don't have to worry about, in case the bookshelf gets really, really heavy, potential of tearing out if I just use the simple pins and drilled holes in them. Never had that problem before, but I really like the adjustability of using a pre-manufactured support like this. So the first thing we need to do is to take that panel, and we're going to route 2 stopped grooves, one on each side of the panel itself, because we're going to have 2 of these on each panel, and we're going to be doing that on all 4 panels because we have 2 for each dresser. So let's go ahead and take a look at the footage that we did of that. And it's really simple, a matter of just setting up a straight edge guide and then routing the grooves. Perhaps the most important part to remember is to do some layout lines so you know exactly where to start and where to stop. So let's take a look at that.
So once I determined where exactly I want the grooves to start, it was just a matter of marking the top and the bottom. And in this situation, the bottom started a little bit higher up from the end than the top did. And that's mainly because we have a fixed shelf that's going to be put right in that position. So it's important to mark which is the top and which is the bottom, because obviously you don't want that groove going all the way through. Well, at least in this situation, I didn't want it. So I went ahead and I marked it. Then using my tri-square, I went ahead, made those lines so that I can reference them. Then grabbed a straight edge. In this case, I'm using a clamping straight edge. Get it in position. And now what I'm going to do is I want to make sure that I know how far away from the edge I need it for the router. So I have that set up on yet another tri-square. Go ahead and double check those. And now for I know for a fact that when I run my router up against that straight edge, it's going to be exactly where I want it. And with that done, then it's a matter of just grabbing the router, slowly dropping it down into place. And now, well, we've sped this up a little bit, but we're going to go ahead and make the groove. Obviously, I wish it could go this fast, but it's not going to. The main thing is take your time so that you don't mess up when you get to those ends, because the last thing you want to do is to blow right through the marks that you made for the start and stop. And then just simply flip it around, check those measurements, and go from there.
So what we're going to do now is we're going to glue up the panel between the legs. And what I want to do is I want to have a quarter inch reveal on the back side here. So to help me achieve that, rather than trying to put the panel in place and then lift it to get it, try and move it into the position, I've set down a quarter inch piece of plywood. And then now when I set the panel in place, it's floating up above that quarter inch mark, so I have it exactly where I want it. Now, it helps, of course, if you make sure that your panel, the quarter inch panel, is narrower than the panel that you're gluing in place, but that's really easy. Just, if necessary, rip it on the table saw or whatever you choose to do, whether a bandsaw or whatever. So, because I need to glue both sides of this, what I'm going to do is, to make it really simple, rather than rushing through, I'm going to do one side at a time. Of course, that can kind of kill our time frame, but you know what? We get a really decent result, and the end result is what's most important. One thing we're really concerned about when it comes to applying the glue is applying too much, because we don't want it dripping all over, especially if you're planning on staining it. Now, this one I'm not planning on staining. I'm just going to be putting on some amber shellac. So if there was any glue spillover, I mean, I can take it off with my scraper, or I can, you know, knock it off with a chisel, and it wouldn't really affect the overall color. But I really want to avoid it as much as possible. When it comes down to it, applying glue is an issue of applying just enough. Sometimes we go a little overkill. So I've got this in place using my handy dandy finger, and we'll just simply drop it in. Now, like I said, we're only going to be doing the one side, so it kind of helps out with the glue up itself. So, okay, now what I'm doing down here is I'm just taking a straight edge and butting it up to the top of the panel and the top of the leg to make sure that they're both exactly in the same plane. And again, this is a lot easier since we're only gluing up one leg at this time. So now that those are in place for the moment, we'll go ahead and we'll apply our first clamp. We'll snug this up, and then what we're going to do is we're going to double check to make sure that it's where it is. And I'm pushing down to make sure that it's nice and flat on that quarter inch panel. Don't need a lot of glue pressure because the joint line is nice and tight, and this is pretty much on its way. So now we'll just simply apply some more clamps along the edge, and this panel is done. At this point in the build project, we went ahead and we just completed cutting the grooves for the adjustable shelving hardware. And of course, as we run into all the time with router bits, the ends of the grooves are rounded over. It's nearly impossible to get a square end from a router bit. If you took a very small diameter one, you could probably make it look very square, but in fact, it would actually be rounded. So what we need to do is we need to square up those corners so that the adjustable hardware will fit in the groove itself from one end to the other. Now, I went ahead and I already did this. I kind of got a little ahead of myself in the project. It often happens when you're building something on commission. So I went ahead and I did this. But let's come over to the workbench and let's talk a little bit about a couple of just tiny details when it comes to squaring up these corners, because there's a few things that can make it really, really easy or really, really hard. So let's talk about it for a second. When it comes to squaring up a corner, like I said, unfortunately with a router bit, we're always going to have some sort of rounded end, and we want to get it nice and square. So the main thing we need to do is come in with our chisels and do the work for us. Now, you might be a little thinking that you could do something like this with the corner chisel accessory that we just recently featured not too long ago. This works great when it comes to mortises, but when it comes to a deeper groove like the one we have here, it'll score the surface, but it's not going to get down as deep as you really want it to. So to get started, we need to make two cuts. We're going to go with the grain, with as the edges, the sides of the groove, and then of course we're going to want a stop cut where we're going to define the top and bottom of the groove. What I like to do is I like to start by defining the top and the bottom. And my main reason for this is it's very easy if we overcut the sides going with the grain for the grain to split wide open. It's much easier to make a cut on a ripping motion than it is on a cross cut. So what I'll end up doing first is, like I said, I make my cross cut mark to get us to define the end, the top and the bottom. And then that's when I'll come in with my chisel and do the long grain going with the grain cuts. One thing I do want to recommend is, it's a little dusty, I gotta clean this workbench up. I like using my smaller chisels when it comes to this versus using the larger one. A lot of people would say, if you use the larger one, you can take a bigger blow with it, you'll get more material out of the way. And it's very true, you will. But often when it comes to these corner cuts, it's not that much material that we need to get out of the way. And to be honest with you, sometimes the problem with a bigger chisel is that it's a brute and it's going to just take away too much. And on top of it, you're not going to have as much control over it because you get the weight moving on this and it's going to get away from you at some point. So for myself, at least, I like to use the smaller ones. If I have to make a couple of passes, if I have to inch it over a little bit to make the line as clean as possible, well, that's what I end up having to do. But I feel like I get a better result, a more controlled result by using a smaller chisel. So in the case of this groove, it's approximately around 5/8 of an inch. I don't have a 5/8 inch chisel. I have a 1/2 inch chisel, and then I have a 3/4 inch chisel. So I go with the smaller one, and then I just simply bump it over to where it needs to be to complete the cut. Now, once we've defined the shoulders of the corner itself, the one on the with the grain and the one across the grain, and we drop the chisel down in there, it's really easy just to kind of come in and we'll simulate this a little bit. We drop the chisel down from the we start at the end, and then we'll drop it from the side. And then once we've managed to get it down to that final depth, we just simply, what I like to do is turn the bevel over so the bevel is facing down. And then I can kind of come in and I'll clean the material out and just kind of pop it out a little bit. And that's how I get it out. And the end result is not too bad. Now, when we take a look at this one, they don't look like the cleanest, but once I get the hardware in place, you're not going to see it and the job is completed. One of the beauties of custom furniture, building our own pieces, is the fact that we have quite a few options. Now, whether the option is tweaking a design to make it more of our own or to fit with existing pieces that we have, whether it's choosing the materials we're going to work with, perhaps we want only solid wood or we want nothing but plywood with maybe some veneer on the edges or a mixture of them, or maybe you want to work with MDF, whatever. You have a whole bunch of options. And along with those options also becomes options for hardware. Now, as we saw in today's first part of this project, we went ahead and routed a groove in which that adjustable shelf strip is going to fit into, and then we'll use the clips and we'll be able to move those to whatever height that we need for the shelves. Now, it's a really easy way to do it, and I think I mentioned the fact that I really like it because they seem to be a little bit more solid. I think they can really stand up to a lot of wear and tear. One thing that's really important when you put those in place is to make sure that if you need to cut them, like I ended up doing for this project, you want to make sure that they're cut at the same length, so therefore when you put them in place they'll match up exactly the same way. And it's not just on one side, you want to make it sure it's true on both sides. So what you would really need is 4 pieces that are exactly the same in every way imaginable. Now, the other options that we have, of course, and I think we're most familiar with these, are these little shelf supports. And I'll make sure to come in here really tight so you can get a look at this. We have basically the shelf support where it looks kind of like a spoon on one end, and then it has the post that would stick into a hole that you would drill into the side of the shelf side. And then you have another one that's probably really familiar with. Again, you have a post, and you essentially have an L bracket that the shelf would sit on. Couple of options with these is you can have